Small as a mustard seed and lofty as a cedar.
The kingdom of God is our own.
While we sleep and rise night and day.
The kingdom of God is our own.
The low are brought high and the high are brought low.
The kingdom of God is our own.
Alleluia. We sing together hymn 42. O sing to the Lord, O sing God a new song. Please be seated. And a very warm welcome to this service of word and sacrament this morning. To any who are here for the first time, you're most welcome. And to those who are joining us online either now or later in the week. Let us join together now as we approach God in prayer. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord our God, for you come to us and seek to make your home with us. Let our ears, our minds, and our hearts be open to you. Let us find our rest in you, that we may grow in grace, in confidence, in joy, and live to your glory. Blessed are you, Creator, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And so, friends, we keep silence now as we acknowledge before God those things in our own lives and in the life of our world for which we need to say sorry. And together we join in our prayer of confession. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. Forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, I've been doing a little bit of gardening recently, or trying to, amidst all the showers in June. We're having April in June, aren't we? And the thunder. Did that scare you to death on Friday night? Our dog cried her little eyes out. Anyway, I've been sorting out my flower beds as best as I can, deciding on what should go where. And I'm realising that I made some errors, some mistakes last year, thinking I knew best where everything should go. And suddenly beginning to realise that I couldn't control what everything needs in my garden. I thought a particular flower would look really good in one place, but now I'm seeing that actually it needed more shade or more light or less wind in order for it to thrive, yeah? But one of the joys I have discovered is that despite my best efforts, nature has its own way of sorting things out. Look at this wonderful little flower, which is coming up on our screen. I hope. There's no image. Okay. We updated the PowerPoint, but obviously that's gone a bit wrong. It's a picture. I took a photograph of a little viola. It's like a little pansy. And it's growing in my garden in the most unexpected of places, in a scrubby bit where there's only stones, no earth. And there's this beautiful little viola. Does that happen in your garden? Yeah. I didn't plant it there. The earth simply provided it for my delight, peeping up through the stones. And then I was going to show you a picture of a whole bunch of chives. Do you like chives? No? Yes. Well, I planted chives in a pot, but the picture is of chives just sprouting up all over the place. How did they get there? The earth provided more chives for me. So, when you are out and about, notice the wonders of nature, the surprises which are everywhere for us to see, and the way God is at work night and day, bringing forth fruit from the earth. Let's just say a prayer as the children leave for junior church. Gracious and loving God, thank you for all the surprises of nature that you bring to us. Bless our children and bless us all as we continue in our worship and our learning. Amen. So we'll sing you on your way.
The reading from the Hebrew Scriptures is taken from Ezekiel chapter 17, verses 22 to 24. Thus says the Lord God, I myself will take a sprig from the lofty top of a cedar. I will set it out. I will break off a tender one from the topmost of its young twigs. I myself will plant it on a high and lofty mountain. On the mountain height of Israel, I will plant it in order that it may produce boughs and bear fruit and become a noble cedar. Under it, every kind of bird will live. In the shade of its branches will nest winged creatures of every kind. All the trees of the field will know that I am the Lord. I bring low the high tree, I make high the low tree, I dry up the green tree, and make the dry tree flourish. I, the Lord, have spoken, I will accomplish it. Holy Wisdom, Holy Word, thanks be to God. A reading from the Gospel according to Mark. Glory to Christ our Saviour. Chapter 4, verses 26 to 34. Jesus also said, the kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes with his sickle, because the harvest has come. He also said, with what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, and puts forth large branches, so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade. With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. This is the gospel of Christ. Praise to Christ our Lord.
Please be seated. You will likely join with me in feeling a great sense of sadness, even loss, at the death of Dr. Michael Mosley. I have to say I was a fan and a follower of this gentle, quirky, brainy soul who reached out to a nation and helped so many of us to think more deeply about our well-being, our health, our lifestyle. It's clear that he is mourned by many. And one of the last things I learned from him was through his late night radio series on sleep. He'd speak gently, I don't know, for about 10 minutes. I generally fall asleep, you see, so I didn't know quite how long he went on. Helping us to slow our breathing, calm our thoughts, leave behind the worries of the world just for a while, and simply let go into a deep sleep. The kingdom of God is like a sleeping gardener. The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise and sleep and rise. The gardener puts the seed into the ground but cannot do anything about its growing. In fact, the gardener has so little to do with making that seed grow. She is able simply to sleep through the process of sprouting and maturation. The kingdom of God is like a sleeping gardener. Do you hear this as an invitation? Is it a relief? Or is it a bit discomforting? Do you long for rest? Or are you itching to go? I mean, sometime around Christmas, we're continually reminded to stay awake. Keep watch, be alert. None of this falling into slumber. Yet in past weeks, the lectionary has returned many times to the theme of taking time, waiting, learning to be at rest in and like the presence of the divine. Susan Derber quips, "This is the Samuel Beckett parable. Nothing happens. Much. Only it does." The key word here is Greek. The Greek word, the earth produces of itself, automate. It's the word from which we get automatically. The seed grows, so something does happen, but without the sower having much to do with it at all. The mystery of growth belongs to the earth and the seed. So actually a lot does happen, but for the most part, it's not a direct result of what the sower does. She simply has to let go into a trust so deep that she can sleep without anxiety, which is far more useful than fussing over this little seed and dousing it with pesticide and digging it up every day to check that it is growing and clucking anxiously over the amount of sun it has. She sows and she reaps, but mostly she rises and she sleeps. The seed grows anyway. Something amazing and life-giving and miraculous just happens, like a gift from nowhere. Does this make you feel relieved or a bit uncomfortable? And in case we didn't get the message with this first parable, Jesus offers a second one. The kingdom of God is like a mustard seed, which, though the smallest of all seeds, grows into a bush so large that birds can make nests in its shade. The imagery of passivity combined with fantastic and disproportionate growth doesn't necessarily sit comfortably with us. It can lead us down the rabbit hole of, well, what's the point of us then? But then we do, I think, miss the point. Because I believe the parable points to one thing: grace. An idea at the heart of the kingdom and so central to our faith that at our baptism service next week, we will declare the prevenience, the going before of God's grace as one of the foundations of our belief. And yet somehow we find it difficult to really receive and believe. We live in an age of anxiety. We live between the time of planting and the harvest, and it's a time of great uncertainty. Different issues pique our anxiety and despair, from the climate emergency to our political landscape and who on earth is going to govern us, to the conflicts in our world and the threat of nuclear annihilation. We want to trust the automatic earth. We want to believe that what God has begun will be brought to fruition. But just in case it isn't, we hedge our bets, doing everything we can to keep our anxiety at bay. And most of the time, well, in church anyway, we see this as our doing our bit to help God. But we do really need to be a bit careful here, because this kind of drivenness can become a compulsion that raises demands on us and others to a fever pitch. We must watch the balance between an anxiety-driven response to the uncertainty of our world and a faith-driven response. Faith that God will be God, that the automatic earth will yield its fruit, and that life in Christ can be trusted. Indeed, intimacy with Christ grows in us as certainly and as effortlessly as seeds grow. Indeed, we have so little to do with Christ's nearness to us that we can simply trust, like the one who falls into deep, restorative sleep. The kingdom of God is not like the frenetic busyness of works righteousness, or the anxious attachment to particular moral or doctrinal positions which we defend with all our energy. And of course, being busy and dogmatic makes a lot of sense to us because it fits in with our normal way of being human. And we achieve all sorts of good by working hard and committing ourselves to our values and to moral and political issues. But the difficulty arises in confusing the way of the kingdom with our ordinary way of doing things. The harvest will come, it will come about through God's grace and God's love, and not through our hard work. This grace, this love, transforms the tiniest and most unimportant looking seed into a huge sprawling bush that gives rest and shade to the singing birds, just as it transforms our tiny, distorted awareness of God into a magnificent luminosity in which all the creatures we meet and us can rest. Now, you'd think in response to this deep profundity, we might throw a party. But not so. Mostly we like to be able to control things and plan them and make them work better by doing something. We like to know that if we do this, that will follow. But that is not how the kingdom of God works. The kingdom of God will come, but it won't be because we strive for it. It will come because God will bring it in. Still feeling a bit uncomfortable? I am. As a church, we have been engaged in a process of discernment about what we are about to be, or what we are to be about, actually, in the next few years. All sorts of big and small ideas are being considered. But I'm interested to note two things. The overwhelming longing which emerged from the away days was the desire for spiritual sanctuary and nourishment. More space to simply rest in God's presence through worship and prayer, through quietness and contemplation. For this place to be a place of rest in a world so frenetic and demanding. A place of sanctuary in the many meanings of that word, for all the birds of the world to rest in its shade safely and at home. And secondly, and in parallel, to work through the arts and issues of social justice to build momentum, encourage action, and energize community. A kind of center for faith and arts and social justice. A place for which the whole community has a sense of ownership and belonging, with worship at its heart. Rest and rising. Friends, God's kingdom grows where it wills. It is not dependent on our best efforts, and we are liberated from determining the harvest or of assuming that our successes or failures hasten or deter God's plans. But we are invited to join in. We are to scatter the seeds, let them fly, and then mirror the kingdom, finding the balance between rest and rising, between being and doing, between owning our moral and ethical and political call to action and paying real attention to our deep need for rest and to provide a place of rest in the divine presence. And above all else, trusting God to be God. Amen. We make our response by singing hymn 158, Lord, you sometimes speak in wonders, unmistakable and clear.
Well, to St Andrew's Sods Lane Church this morning. Do please stay and join us for a cup of tea or coffee after the service. It would be lovely to chat and spend some time together. There's a copy of the church notices at the back of the church if you haven't already received them by email. If you want to receive them by email, then please fill in one of the little postcards and we can start doing that. There's just one thing that I'd like to highlight this week. The church has recently re-advertised its position of music director, a really important role in the life and worship of this church. And so do please spread the word about that position all around Sheffield and nationally. Someone might move here to come and be our music director, which would be wonderful. So do please spread the word that for anyone that might be interested in supporting the church with that role. Thank you.
We thank you, Lord, for promising through your Son, Jesus, to hear us when we pray in faith. Thank you for bright, warm June sunshine. When we see it, we really appreciate it. We're sorry that we can't stop burning things and have messed up our weather. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Strengthen your church, not just here, but everywhere people worship, so that we might be a force for good, not a cause for division. As we speak of your love, show us how to act it out in tolerance, kindness, and generosity. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless and guide Charles, our King, as he works out how to fulfill his role. Thank you that he has knighted Alan Bates as an open recognition of previous injustice, justice done in his courts. We ask that those seeking peaceful solutions to wars, blasting trees and people in equal measure, are successful. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give grace to our families and friends, those who come together to support us in times of stress. Thank you for bananas that can console a small people when they've had a disaster. They're nearly as good as chocolate. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Comfort and heal those who are sick. We all need your wholeness. Empower those whose gift is healing, and the medicine they bring is laughter, seeing the ridiculous in a situation, changing the nature of tears. Thank you for bananas. As one of our children said, it's all Licrudius. We all have a list of those close to us who are sick. We hold them before you now. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We remember those who have died, whether peacefully in bed at a great age or cut short by war. Their loss always hurts. Bless the bereaved with confidence in your promise of eternal life. Rejoicing in the fellowship of Andrew and all your saints, we commend all to your unfailing love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Bless, O God, the gifts that we bring on this day, that they may be a sign of our commitment to your kingdom and a pledge of our love for you and for your world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. When the children return, we'll continue with our service of Holy Communion. For those of you who may be new here, we practice an open table. Jesus invited everyone to his table without exception, and we do the same. There is fermented wine in the chalice and unfermented wine in the small glasses, and the bread is gluten-free. Here they come. I think. You really are, aren't you? Hello, welcome back. Have we got something to share? Yeah? Yeah? Are there more to come? Yes, hello. Yeah. Now, come on here so that everybody can see. Just tell me what you've been doing this morning. I want you to speak into here.
We've been making birds.
You've been making birds. And why have you been making birds?
Because we were learning about when Jesus was baptized.
Uh-huh. And what happened?
And a dove came down and landed on his shoulder.
Yeah. And words from heaven were spoken, weren't they? I think. And a voice said, "This is my beloved, in whom I am well pleased," I think. And have you been learning about baptism then?
Yes.
And why have you been learning about baptism? Have we got one coming?
Next week.
That's right, we have. Well, how wonderful. And so what's with the baby?
This baby got baptized today, and her name is Roberta the Third, or for short, Bob.
Did you hear all of that? That they've been practicing baptizing. It's good. We've got vicars in the making. It's marvelous. And they've named the baby Roberta the Third, aka Bob. Okay? Thank you so much for sharing what you've been doing. It sounds wonderful. I invite you to stand now as we share the peace. We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Let us therefore keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us greet one another in the name of Christ. Our communion hymn is number 168. Come, Lord Jesus, come into this world of ours.
Jesus.
The Lord is here.
His Spirit is here.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Holy God. It is indeed right, it is our duty and joy, gracious and holy God, always and everywhere to give you thanks. In the beginning, your Spirit swept across the face of the waters, bringing order and beauty out of chaos. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. And though we turned away from you, your love remained steadfast. And you sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, to be the Saviour of the world. Sharing our human nature, he died on the cross. Raised again in glory, he lives forever to pray for us. By the gift of the Spirit, whom you have sent in his name, you bring to completion the work of your Son, leading us into all truth, making us a people for your praise, and giving us power to proclaim the gospel in all the world. And so, with all the faithful of every time and place, we join with choirs of angels in the eternal hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. On the night before he died, Jesus took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup of wine, he gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for all people. Do this in remembrance of me." And so we offer you these gifts, and with them ourselves, as a holy, living sacrifice. You send forth your Spirit. You bind us in love. You renew the face of the earth. Pour out your Spirit, that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us the body and blood of Christ. Unite us with him and with one another in mission to all the world, and bring us with the whole creation to your heavenly kingdom. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Please be seated.
This is the bread of life,
and this is the wine of compassion. The gifts of God for the people of God. Come, all is now ready.
Thank you.
And so we pray together. God of power, may the boldness of your Spirit transform us. May the gentleness of your Spirit lead us. And may the gifts of your Spirit equip us to serve and worship you now and always. Amen. And so we come to our final hymn. Now thank we all our God with hearts and hands and voices. May God bless you with new life, Christ tend you in grace, and the Holy Spirit guide your steps as you walk by faith, now and forever. Amen. Go in light and peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.